What was that, like Skeletor? Where's the real intro? Hey there, students. Tom Richey here, and I am joined by a special guest, Timm Freitas from the Garden of English. And I think that APUSH teachers, AP Lang teachers are always wondering, like, okay, what are these two similar tasks? The DBQ, the document-based question, and the synthesis essay. So y'all go ahead and drop a subscribe, all of that kind of stuff. Some more information on Tim's channel is going to be there in the description. So Timm, what is it we're looking to do here?
Yeah, so, you know, my kids consistently ask me about the DBQ, and they consistently ask me about, like, how synthesis relates to the DBQ. And quite frankly, I haven't really had much of an idea besides the fact that I've heard that they're similar. And so because of that, I was like, I got to find out somebody who knows this kind of stuff, right? And if all you have to do is, you know, type in APUS into Google and who shows up but the one and only Tom Richey. So why not reach out to the Tom Richey and have this conversation? So what we're going to try to do, I think, you know, I'm looking to kind of say, hey, here's where our tasks are similar, but they're different tasks. And we want to make sure that's pretty clear on both sides, because I'm not sure we've had a full conversation like this before, you know?
Yeah, definitely. And we've had a really good chat, you know, coming up on this. And we know, since these things are so similar, that your essay has 7 points, just like mine, right?
No, absolutely not. No way. Nope.
Okay, so how many?
We've got 6. So we're at 6.
Okay, so on the DBQ, these points are largely independent of each other, like where there are a few of them that'll build. Most of these points are just, you know, you used outside evidence, or you have contextualization, or there's a thesis. Yours, I guess, same way?
Nope, absolutely not. Once again, okay, so we're already, you know, clarifying some, you know, some differences here. They're not, ours are largely codependent. We have a thesis point, and we've got a sophistication point, but then we've got another 4 points that are pushed for evidence and commentary. And quite frankly, yeah, so we're at 6. And quite frankly, if you don't get the thesis point, it's really hard to actually score above a 2 on the evidence and commentary. In fact, I don't think that you will. And you certainly won't get the sophistication point. So there's a lot going on there where that thesis point is really going to drive a lot of what's going forward.
Okay. And I would say that's actually something that we've got in common there, Timm, because the thesis point is definitely important. Now, I would say that a student could very easily get maybe 4 to 5, even 5 points without having a thesis. But then again, like you say, you're talking about the sophistication point, and we call that point complex understanding. And without a thesis, that's not likely to happen. So I think we can agree that a thesis statement is very, very important here as we're going into this. And of course, that it is very important on the DBQ to put your thesis in the first or in the final paragraph. Because
So that might work on the DBQ, but that's not what it's working on for the synthesis paper, right? Luckily, with AP Lang, it looks as though we're a little bit more, you know, open here. You can have your thesis anywhere you want in your paper. However, I will have to admit, right? I will have to admit that is it best to kind of put your thesis first? Absolutely. In fact, I actually encourage my kids to not even write a full intro paragraph. I say, hey, just your thesis only. That's what I tell my kids. Put your thesis statement right there, and then boom, go straight into your paper.
Okay, so now that's something that I think we can both agree that it's a good idea to go ahead and put your thesis first. Yeah. Now, of course, people who are looking for full credit on the DBQ, usually I encourage them to write a few sentences of contextualization at the very beginning. Now, of course, contextualization can go anywhere, but yeah, that's something worth noting for students who are taking both exams. Make sure that, you know, the thesis definitely doesn't hurt on either essay to put it at the very beginning. But then again, on the DBQ, you can put it at the end, and it sounds like, you know, on Timm's, you can do it, I guess, anywhere you want, really.
Right. The thing is, though, I think that most readers do actually look for it right at the beginning. And because of that, like, it's best to just toss it there. And the other thing, too, like on my essay, there's no sense in writing a full intro paragraph when most of your points fall into evidence and commentary. So I always tell my kids, like, there's no reason to sit down and be like, how am I going to start my essay? What's my context here? Like, they can contextualize throughout their whole paper with what they're looking for. I'm just like, okay, hit them with your thesis and go, and really try to develop your argument.
And I think that's part of that holistic strategy there that you've got, Timm, where these points are really building on each other in your essay Whereas on the DBQ, most of this is just, okay, is this box checked? Is this box checked? Is this box checked?
Gotcha.
So the strategy about trying to put contextualization and thesis at the beginning of a DBQ is so that you can go ahead and score 2 points right off the bat.
Right.
Now, as far as the questions that are being posed, on the DBQ, it's always going to be a historical question, typically dealing with some kind of cause and effect or continuity and change over time, or even sometimes, some other things. The APUSH DBQ topic can be worded in different ways, but it's typically going to take a historical event that most people are going to have some familiarity with. Okay, so yep. Recently we've seen, there can be one on the American Revolution, World War I, reform movements, these things that, maybe a student's not going to be an expert on, but it's typically going to be expected that a student who has any chance of passing the exam has at least heard of the topic that is being discussed in the DBQ.
Gotcha. Yeah, that's not happening on ours, right? There are sometimes, a lot of times kids will have some sort of experience with the topic, but there are times when that is just not the case. A few years ago, they had a prompt about eminent domain. They had a prompt about like being a museum curator a few years ago. They had a prompt about locavorism. So basically for the synthesis paper, there is a chance that you might not know very much about what's going on in the actual topic of the paper until you get your sources and you read about it. So my students are not required at all to actually have knowledge of the topic at hand in order to be able to respond effectively to it. They can do a lot of their own kind of self-education there because our prompts are more like practical prompts as opposed to like kind of, the cause and effect element of history or the process analysis of history. It's going to be one of those things that it's like, hey, what does this look like if you're going to institute this in your community? Or what does this look like? A couple of years ago, they did one about libraries. What's the role of libraries in the future? So it seems to me that the difference of the prompt typically is that ours is a little bit more practical there.
Okay, yeah, and that's definitely good that people don't have to know something about it. I mean, for example, I've never been a museum coordinator. I've never been a museum curator. I have trouble saying curator. So it's something I've never done. Now, on the DBQ, it definitely helps if you know a bit about the topic. There's actually one of the points, it is required, actually two of the 7 points, one of them being outside evidence and contextualization, that there are actually 2 points that would require you to know something about it and be able to contribute something. Usually there are some obvious gaps, okay? So for example, if it's about Jefferson's presidency, there probably won't be anything about the Louisiana Purchase in the documents.
Yeah.
And so with that, it helps if you know something about it. And if you don't know anything about it, then you can score 4 points. If you just, you have a thesis statement and you use the documents, you could score 4 points, which is also putting you on a solid path to passing the exam. Typically, the average score on a DBQ is going to be about a 3 out of 7 points.
Oh, no kidding.
What about yours, Tim?
Yeah, no, that's not how we're rolling here. If you want to be on the fast track to get a qualifying score on your exam, you definitely want to get a 4 out of those 6 points. So you want to score a 1 for your thesis, a 3 for your evidence and commentary, and potentially your sophistication point. But a 1-3-0 is certainly the case. And also for us, once again, there's no need for contextualization for us. You don't need that. Now, that does help for the sophistication point, but there are a couple of different ways to earn the sophistication point. The only problem is that in the AP Lang prompt, in the AP Lang rubric, there's no checklist for it. So you can position your argument in the broader context, but you can also have a vivid and persuasive style. So that means that if I bring in no element of context, I can still bring in full marks if I've got a really good writer here. And actually, for us, our argument has to be central, and you can write a pretty mechanical argument and still score a 1-4-0, which is a 5 out of 6 points, which is good. But, if you really want to get that 1-4-1, you got to be a good writer. There's no doubt about that.
Okay, got it. And I think that's a little bit different from what we're doing on the history side for the DBQ, because you're really just, you're making a very mechanical argument. Now, it doesn't hurt if somebody is, putting in an occasional joke or something like that. We'll even do a little gag sometimes, but they'll write something down and kind of embed it in there. But at the same time, for the most part, It's very mechanical writing. There's actually been a few times, Tim, that I've told students, you're trying too hard to be a good writer. Okay. And now I'm
getting
why that is. And I hate to tell students this, you know, it's just like a historian, you know, tell them what you're going to say, say it, and tell them again what you just said. Gotcha. And so it's really much, it's about like organizing the documents to create an argument. And there's really not anything for style, like even in, you know, when you're going for complexity. And often if a student is trying too much, you know, trying too hard to have style, then a lot of times they're going to forget that technical stuff that they need to have in this essay. Mm-hmm. And so I can definitely see why on one hand, you know, I see, oh, this student is putting emphasis on good writing. Don't do so much of that. But on your essay, which it makes sense, it's English. So yeah, that makes sense that they should be a good writer.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And you know what? I think that our essay is a lot about using and engaging with a full set of rhetorical tools, right? It's like, hey, can we create an argument? Can we be lucid in our communication of that argument? Can we keep things together, right? And also, because this is the synthesis paper, we definitely got to quote our three sources. There's no doubt about that, right? And so it's really important when as you create that vivid and persuasive style and you bring in those moments that you are directly quoting from our sources, no doubt.
Oh, direct. Oh, okay. Yeah. So this is where on the DBQ. Now, of course, when you say sources, we say documents. So right. You've got six sources.
Yeah, six
and
sources.
We've got seven documents. Now, it sounds like in both cases, a student needs to use at least three.
Yeah. Yeah. We must. So you have to cite at least three in order to score a one. In order to get a two in evidence and commentary, you have to use at least three documents. So if you don't get three documents in, the highest you could score in evidence and commentary is a one. So you could have a thesis, an incredible body paragraph, but you've only got two sources in that one incredible body paragraph. It's going to be a 1-1-0. It cannot. But if you actually get three sources in your paper with that thesis and one body paragraph, if it's really that good, you might even be able to get a score a 1-4-0. A 1-3-0 from just a thesis and a singular body paragraph. But for us, now you can, for us, you can paraphrase and you can summarize, but I tell my students, you need to quote those documents, particularly because when you quote it and it's like seamless with your writing, that's going to show that you are fully synthesized in. Now, you know, can they quote it? I mean, can they paraphrase it? Yes. Can they summarize it? Yes. But they better cite it. That's also, that's a fact too.
Okay, got it. See, so on the DBQ, the whole point is to make sure. Now, the most points somebody will get for less than three documents, they could get a 3 out of 7 for having a thesis, contextualization, and outside evidence.
But that's good. You said that's good earlier though, right?
Yeah, I mean, well, three, it puts them on track to passing the exam. Gotcha. So now I would not recommend the no document strategy, but there are 3 points that are independent of any of the documents.
Gotcha.
But as far as that goes, there is the what I call the I love lamp point, you know, where somebody is like, you know, basically you've got to show on this DBQ that you read the document and you understand it. And so when I quote the document, it's not demonstrating understanding. So sometimes if a student is quoting, now, if it's like 3 or 4 words, a short phrase that yeah. I couldn't have said this better myself, then that's fine. But as far as quoting an entire sentence or something like that, I'll write in big red letters, all caps, you know, I know what the documents say. Yeah. Like transcribing the documents is yeah. not a useful skill for a historian.
So I will agree with that because with my students, right, I always tell them if you're putting, when you seamlessly interweave your quotes, that you are not using these sentences as their own single sentences in your paper. You're weaving parts of them in with yours. And I tell my students, you've got 12 words per set of quotes. Now, you can write a nice, long, flowing, beautiful sentence that's got 3 sources in it, and that's fine. But when you put those sources in, you better be using less than 12 words. My general rule of thumb is typically 12, and my kids typically operate between, 4 and 9.
Okay, got it. Okay, so 12 words, whereas for me, I would say 3 to 4. So that's something that is very interesting. Looking at this here. Okay. Right. So yeah. And if I don't see a single quote on a DBQ, then I'm going to be fine with that. If I don't see any quoted material, because by paraphrasing and summarizing, that is something important. Now, also on the documents for the DBQ, another thing, Tim, is for the document as a whole does not necessarily have to be referenced.
You can plagiarize on your exam?
Well, now I'm saying, like, they don't have to talk about the whole thing, right?
Gotcha. I'm just kidding.
Not quite there, but yeah. So with that, they can use a part of the document, where as long as they're, as long as they're referring to that part of the document, that is fine. So they don't have to necessarily have understood the entirety of the document as long as the part of the document that they referenced was understood. Now, when we talk about citing, one thing that we need is the document does need to have a direct reference to the document. So it can't have a passing reference to the topic of the document. So definitely having something, I discourage, even though technically a student gets the point, but I discourage like document one says, document two says, and to actually like refer to the person who is writing the document. And then the citation, the parenthetical citation, doc 5, doc 2, that's something that is definitely, it is good form. It is encouraged in the classroom. I say it's a must, but on the exam, it's more of a courtesy to the reader because the reader will know if it said, well, Ben Franklin wrote in whatever newspaper, da-da-da-da-da. Then we know that since they've mentioned Ben Franklin in the Pennsylvania Gazette, that they're referring to document 4 because that's what document 4 is.
Right. So for us, that citation's an obligation. Now, that doesn't mean that if you like, so let's say we had a Ben Franklin document. If they put Ben Franklin's name, like Ben Franklin wrote or argued or theorized blank in their sentence, well, clearly you've cited the source in the sentence. So you wouldn't have to put source D in parentheses at the end, right? But if let's say Ben Franklin said, I wrote the speech of Polly Baker, and sure enough, right, I can write my sentence and be like, and then there was someone who revealed that he wrote the speech of Polly Baker. I would have to put, and let's say it was source D, I'd have to either parenthetically cite source D or Franklin. And that's the only way you're going to actually get that kind of source point. You need to make sure that you connect your sources and you cite them so that we know that you've done it at least 3 times. Now, obviously, once again, it says you can use the last name or you can use source A, source B, source C. And because I have my kids weave their sources in their sentences, I always tell them just put in the parenthetical at the end. And I'm like, even if you put the person's name in the sentence, just write source A in parentheses at the end just in case to make sure that nobody forgets that you've cited everything, even though that's not really MLA citation.
Yeah, and I think that this is somewhere where we're actually complementing each other here, because what is mandatory on your end is definitely like it's good form on my end. So I would say that when we're talking about, making a specific reference to the author of the document, citing it parenthetically when you're done with it, for both of these exams, this is going to be well received. And another thing that I think, from our little pre-roll conversation, is that putting the documents in conversation with each other is definitely something useful on the DBQ. One thing that I typically advise is for students to put the documents into 2 or 3 argumentative groups. Like for every document you're using, find that document a buddy. So
that they can either
corroborate or they can disagree with each other. And how does that work on your side?
I'm encouraging my students to do the same thing, because one of the ways that you can get the sophistication point, which is a lot like your complexity point, is to look at the tensions within the documents and how they actually interrelate. And so for me, with my students, I'm like, hey, look it, you need to figure out, does this document complement the other document? Does it argue with? Does it support? Does it actually seemingly contest with it, but also agree in other parts so that they can actually work it together? But I also, for my students, right, I have them think about ideas. So they'll read documents and they'll say, okay, this document is about this idea in relation to this problem. So let's say they're doing a windmills prompt, right? And they have a document that's all about sustainability. And then there's another document about how it's really not the most sustainable practice. Then I'm like, okay, so you've got your sustainability documents. Cool. Right. And then there's another one that talks about, economics and job growth. And then another one that talks about economics and job growth, where it's like, maybe it's not as good. And then I'm like, there's your economics kind of group there. And when you have to write a paper that says, develop a position on what needs to be thought about when establishing wind farms, boom, sustainability and economics. And then we're done. So they're grouping with ideas.
Okay. And one thing that I'm hearing here, Tim, if I'm hearing this right, is that for the DBQ, I find that when they group the documents into argumentative groups like this, the thesis practically writes itself.
Yeah.
Okay. So the general structure is really something that what students are learning in your classroom, they can bring that general structure into my classroom.
Yep.
And they can, you know, now you've got to keep in mind these specific things that are different. But as far as just the skeletal outline of this, that is that's definitely, I think, has something in common. Now, you mentioned your sophistication point. You know, and when we think about this, that, you know, where we're thinking about the argument. OK,
yeah.
So this is about argumentation. And,
right.
You know, for going from there, you know, you're making your historical argument. Now, sophistication or complexity on this. See, you've got me using your words now.
That's it. That's why I'm trying to convince you that we've got the better way here. You know,
oh, my God. Next thing I'm going to be telling students to quote documents or something like that. And so the thing is that, you know, their argumentation, like when we think about the complexity point, now it is, you know, I think in both of our subjects, they refer to it as like the unicorn, right?
Oh, for sure. Yeah. It's hard to grab.
Okay. And it's not necessary to get a five. Like, and is that the same case?
Yeah.
For you?
If you could write a mechanical paper that has a strong argument that's well-reasoned and supported with evidence, has your three sources, and score a 140 on your essay. So that's a 5 out of 6 points. If you write a 5 out of 6 points on all of your essays and you get, you know, more than half your multiple choice right, you're going to be in a good spot to get a 4 or maybe even a low 5 on your exam. You probably want to get about, you know, 2/3 of your multiple choice right for that. But getting those 5 out of 6 points, that you do not need the sophistication point on your essays to actually score a 5 on your exam. Not a way. No way.
Got you. And for the complexity point on the DBQ, a lot of it is based on making a more nuanced argument or acknowledging that there's another side.
Yeah.
So if I'm making an argument that's not complex, I say that, you know, this was this way because of this and this. Okay. Yeah. So X because of Y and Z. Whereas then when I'm thinking complexity, I take a position and I say that this is where I'm coming from. So for example, you know, the Great Depression was caused by, you know, that was caused primarily by the failure of financial institutions,
yeah.
But then was also influenced by overconsumption and some of Herbert Hoover's bad decision making.
Yeah.
So with that, I'm going into, rather than saying like, okay, this is about the failure of, you know, banks and the stock market, and going with that more simplistic argument. So the wider I make the argument while still saying that here's my number one argument, but
yep.
Then here's my second one or my 2 and 3 or something like that, then that is presenting a more complex understanding and shows the reader that you weren't ignorant of the other, you know, of other perspectives on
yep.
this historical phenomenon. So again, the reader, you don't have a right to that. The reader does not owe you the point. And basically on the DBQ, it says reasons can include, and it's got 5 or 6 different reasons a reader can award the point.
Yeah.
But again, it's always about this was an outstanding essay, period. It wasn't just, it didn't just have a nice moment somewhere. You know what I mean?
Right. Oh yeah. For us, our sophistication point is definitely through the essay as well. There's no doubt about that. Like you might have one line where you're just like, wow, that was great, but that's not going to earn you the point. When you've got a nice complex thesis, and the way that I teach my kids to write complex thesis statements is to actually have a subordinating clause in their thesis, right? And I know how much you love hearing about grammar, and you're like, I do the same thing, I'm sure of it, right? But I always teach them, if you have a subordinate clause in your thesis, you're going to have what's called a complex sentence. Like that's what the actual sentence is called. So you're going to have a complex thought. The thing is, though, is that I might be able to say, if I go back to this idea of windmills, hey, you know, there's a person needs to consider the economic benefits the economic effects and the sustainability effects because windmills are going to actually be the way of the future. Now, notice that's a singular argument. It doesn't really look for nuance, but it's still considered a complex thesis because we've got the word because there. And now I'm connecting all of that to this idea of like, hey, it's the way of the future. So that can actually still lead to a complex argument on our side.
okay, interesting. Because on my side, the because is kind of necessary. Like there's got to be some kind of thing there typically for the thesis. It has to be, here's my claim, and I'm making this claim because of this and this.
Yeah.
Whereas we broaden it out a little bit. Now, when you talk about a subordinating clause, did I hear that correctly?
Yep.
Is this what I'm referring to as kind of like a counter argument, like a qualifier or something?
Yeah, typically, right? Now, like I said, you know, in the last example I just gave, it's actually a straight argument that just says, hey, you know, these sustainable practices are good for the economy and because it's the way of the future. So that's not going to be the counter argument. But a lot of times the way kids do it is if the prompt allows for it, and most of them do, you just throw an although on there, you know, although this, boom, this.
And that kind of although or however.
Yeah.
That's where we're making complex arguments on the history side. So,
yeah.
So interesting. So this is, and this has been a really good exercise for me, Timm, because like I said, we were, you know, you and I talked for about an hour last night putting this together and really going through that. And it's, you know, hopefully, you know, teachers who have watched this as well as students are finding something worthwhile here. And remember that I've got a link to Timm's channel here in the description. Timm, just tell us a little bit more about what they can see on your channel when they subscribe.
Yeah, so basically we're bringing similar skills into the task, and the task is definitely similar, but we're not doing it the same way, right? So if you want more about the synthesis, you know, paper, if you subscribe to the Garden of English, we've got a whole playlist for that, right? But the thing is, you know, you're writing for history, we're writing for English, right? We're writing for the argument in terms of can we get the reasonable argument here? You're trying to convey that historical knowledge and have a reasonable argument as well. But because of that, they are a little bit of a different task. And so I think it's important to kind of just see what those differences are and know that, you know, that some of the skills transfer, but we've got a different beast, I think, before both of us, you know?
All right. Well, Timm, I appreciate you stopping by today, and hopefully you'll invite me over to the Garden of English sometime.
Oh, we're happy
to
have you.
Remember, y'all, you know, give us a like and a comment and all that. Let us know how this helped you. And as always, it's always a pleasure.
Have a good one.